Namaste, Yoga Bandhus. I bring International Day of Yoga greetings from Swami Vivekananda Yoga Anusandhan Samsthana, which is a deemed to be university in Bengaluru, India, to all the participants of this international webinar on evidence-based lifestyle modifications through yoga during this COVID-19 pandemic. I am so happy to note that this webinar is being organized by the Vishwa Bharati University, and I congratulate all the organizers for bringing in this wonderful theme for this year's International Day of Yoga celebrations. For this webinar, I am asked to talk about the science of pranayama. So it is well known that the prana, which is the vital force, plays the most important role in an individual's life. Among the five different varieties of prana which regulate various functions of our body, the mukhya prana acts as the center of gravity to our physiological system. Breath is the physical manifestation of this vital force, and breathing is the process which keeps this human machinery working. There are only two processes very well known to us when you talk about pranayama and breathing, which is inhalation and exhalation. So if you ask the basic fundamental question, what is pranayama all about? Pranayama forms the fourth limb of Ashtanga Yoga or Raja Yoga, as described by sage Patanjali. Patanjali defines it as Tasmin Sati Shwasa Prashwasa Yor Gati Vichedaha Pranayama. If I have to pick very important key words from this definition, I pick these four: Shwasa, Prashwasa, Gati, and Vichedana. So, which stands for inhalation, exhalation, speed, and the process of breaking this speed. This is also very well known to yoga practitioners that we can do this process of breath holding either externally called Bahya Kumbhaka or internally called Antar Kumbhaka. And it is said in yoga texts that this should happen naturally. For example, that is what is called as Kevala Kumbhaka. So whether you bring this cessation through the practice of yoga or whether it happens by any other means, it has to be made natural. Hence, it is said that Kevala Kumbhaka is the final goal. And Patanjali also has emphasized on three factors when we actually consider pranayama. They are desha, which is the location, kala, which is the time or the duration, and sankhya, which is the number of cycles of breathing which is involved in pranayama when we do it as a practice. The other one of the most important yoga texts, which is Hatha Yoga Pradipika, describes this process of breath holding as Kumbhaka. Hatha Yoga Pradipika describes 8 different techniques of achieving the same, which is cessation of breathing. One shloka defines all these 8 different practices: Surya Bedana Mujjayi Shitakari Shitali Tata Bastrika Brahmari Murcha Plavini Tyasta Kumbhaka Asta Kumbhaka is what it is described as, 8 different methods. These have been conceptualized keeping in mind the requirements and the science behind them. Imagine if the effects of various breathing techniques have to be same, then probably absolutely there was no requirement of bringing these different 8 different techniques as Kumbhakas. At the same time, the science behind them was also very well known to the ancient seers who conceptualized these techniques. When we want to bring it into a practice, we use nostril manipulation, we do mouth breathing, and we do it with resonance at times. And we also use resistive breathing to bring in some of these techniques for practice. A simple way to understand pranayama, as I always felt, was through this definition, pranasya ayamaha iti pranayamaha, the process of extending the length of cycle of breathing. So the anatomy includes the flow of this vital force through specialized channels called nadis. which includes three major nadis, which are very well known to many yoga practitioners, Ida, Pingala and Sushumna. And there are 72,000 minor nadis, which are linked through plexus. And the central channel, which is connected through six such major plexus, are called chakras. I won't go into the details of ancient description as given as anatomy of Nadividya, Nadi Shastra. So, but if I want to put it in much simpler way, I consider breathing as the magic power within us. So we learn a lot observing the nature. There are animals like whales, tortoise, dogs. What differentiates them from each other apart from their structure, you can definitely point out that it is their breathing. Those breathe very fast have short lifespan versus those who breathe slow, which live for hundreds of years. There is no further evidence needed to understand this phenomenon. Our cellular aging is probably directly connected with our breathing speed, and breathing is also strongly connected with our thought processes. So, if we want to really understand this principle very well, once again, we need to go back to our ancient text, which illustrates this through this sloka, chale vate chale chittam nischalam nischalo bhavet yogis tanutvam apnoti tado vayu nirodaye. It is said that the faster you breathe, the quicker your thoughts are. The slower you breathe, the calmer your mind is. So the way you want to use your mind probably can be regulated through the breath cycle or the process of breathing. You can experiment and see that imagine you can't show your anger with slow breathing, while you can't show that you are relaxed with very fast breathing. Imagine lying on a yoga mat and relaxing yourself while doing very fast breathing. Absolutely, you need to slow down your breath to bring your physiological processes to their rest. So let us understand in next few minutes the science behind pranayama. So it is very well known to all of us that the science which is described in ancient times and the science what we are trying to understand today are very close to each other. We only differentiate and say that is very old and we need to understand it in a different way today. But though it is obvious that the focus is on respiratory system when you want to understand the science behind pranayama, it is not limited to the same. The gross function of breathing and the associated techniques can lead to subtle understanding of pranayama. So when you really want to get into the details of science of pranayama, the important components you should definitely explore are the anatomical structures involved in breathing, physiology of breathing, neurophysiological correlates of breathing, and applications of breath regulation in health and disease, and definitely application of these three factors what Patanjali has mentioned. Desha, which is a different parts which you use as respiratory apparatus for breathing. Then the kala, the duration of breathing, and the sankhya, the number of cycles per minute. Particularly when you really want to correlate it with slow breathing, fast breathing, rapid and shallow breathing, etc., and their physiological effects. So there was also attempts made to gain voluntary control over involuntary functions through yoga. Like many other functions, breathing is also believed to be an involuntary function controlled by your brain. Particularly the lower part of the brain called the brainstem. It is also influenced by the chemical content in the blood, mainly the carbon dioxide. When you actually look at respiration as a function, it fulfills various requirements of our body. It helps in construction of the body by supplying oxygen, which is needed for various processes which generate energy. It also helps in sustenance, and it also helps in elimination of waste products such as which are products of physiological processes such as carbon dioxide. The ability to make this process voluntary was the special art and science which great yogis had realized through the process of pranayama. So we always believe that, be it cardiac function, respiration, metabolism, etc., these are all involuntary, but great yogis have achieved this through the practices and they have made them voluntary. When we bring in the science behind pranayama, we can split it across three categories. One is in healthy individuals, another is in diseased individuals, the third category for rehabilitation. So in healthy individuals, when practice of pranayama is used, we would look at their influence primarily, number one, on the nervous system functioning. In 1970s, precisely 1971, a scientist by name Kuning had demonstrated that there is a possibility of influencing the opposite hemisphere of the brain by injecting a substance to the mucous membrane of the nostril. This has demonstrated wide applications that we talk about uninostril yoga breathing, and many used to ask that how does it matter when you breathe in through right nostril or left nostril, as the difference is only 2.5 inches, beyond which the air goes into the same passage. If this research, what was quoted above, was true, then probably we have lots of applications whereby we can look at right nostril influencing the left hemisphere and the left nostril influencing probably the right hemisphere. The right nostril breathing is known to influence the sympathetic nervous system, while the left nostril influences the parasympathetic nervous system. So we know that the right nostril is also believed to be a stimulating pranayama when you breathe through the right nostril, while when you breathe through the left nostril, it is a relaxing pranayama. Pranayama is also known to influence higher brain functions, including memory, attention, concentration, which includes executive functions and learning processes. So studies using EEG and evoked potentials have demonstrated that uninostril yoga breathing can make information processing in the brain much quicker and helps in recruiting more number of neurons for doing this task. When you look at the parts of the brain involved, the frontal lobe, which is responsible for various executive functions, the temporal lobe and parietal lobes, which contribute to cognitive functions, and the major relay center, which is the thalamo-hypothalamic areas, are also shown to be activated during the practice of pranayama. So it is not just one system like a nervous system bringing all these changes. It is a multi-system effect. The involvement of hypothalamo-pituitary-adrenal axis was seen consistently with various pranayama practices. The alternate nostril breathing has been shown to bring in balancing effect compared to others. This is also shown to reduce enhanced stress response, which increases blood pressure, heart rate, blood sugar levels, as well as stress hormones such as cortisol. Slow breathing is also shown to influence the inflammatory responses and biochemicals responsible for them. Various studies have demonstrated that pranayama can reduce pro-inflammatory cytokines and promote healing successfully. When you want to really look at the categorization of pranayama, we can put them into two major categories. One is stimulating pranayamas, another is relaxing pranayamas. So stimulating are those which arouses physiological responses, while relaxing pranayamas are those which bring this arousal back to normalcy. The right nostril breathing, Bhastrika, Ujjayi, Bhramari are commonly known as stimulating pranayamas, while left nostril breathing, Shitkari, Shitali are known for their relaxing effects. Both categories are also known to bring deep relaxing effects after the practice compared to during the practice. So as per this classification, though we say some of them are stimulating pranayamas, but after the completion of that round of inhalation and exhalation, then the practice takes you to deep relaxation. That's the beauty of various pranayamas. With this understanding of physiological changes following pranayama, attempts are being made to apply these beneficial effects in disease management. Pranayama plays an important role, certainly in disease management. Various non-communicable diseases such as diabetes, where a particular breathing technique has been shown to reduce insulin resistance on one side, it can also bring in a change in the overall personality. And obesity, where it can increase metabolic rate, reduce inflammation with better lifestyle. Heart disease, where it can reduce inflammation, reduce blockage, and then associated ischemia. It can also benefit extensively in musculoskeletal problems, like it relaxes your muscles, improves oxygenation, increases secretion of endorphins, and hence brings in pain management. Pranayama also has a very vital role to play in women health. It reduces those stress hormones, which actually creates lots of issues in women. It increases oxytocin, the cuddle hormone. It also optimizes female reproductive health. There are several studies to talk about these factors well in detail. This is a summary of what I am putting it for you. And the last area, as I was talking, is about rehabilitation. Kumbhaka is known to improve selective blood flow in the cortical areas, hence providing better oxygenation in the affected areas by conditions such as stroke. Also important in conditions of neurodegenerative disorders and aging related problems. Practicing pranayama is also shown to improve neural plasticity, and it is speculated that it can facilitate neural regeneration, which requires definitely further research. In summary, pranayama can make us live healthy, prevent diseases, live longer. We are dependent on external agents to maintain our health when we can manage ourselves very well using our internal tools. And pranayama can make us look inwards and make our internal system much better. So let us use these wonderful techniques, which are traditionally rooted, scientifically validated, for a better tomorrow. I thank Dr. Samiran Mandal and the members of the organizing committee for this opportunity. Wishing you all a happy International Day of Yoga. Namaste.